Can a scholarship change the world? A wise man once said,
one of the ways to make the world a better place is to have more smarter, energetic people in it.
20 years ago, the Gates Cambridge Scholarship was created to bring the smartest, most energetic graduates to Cambridge, help them become leaders so they can improve the lives of people everywhere and make their voices count. Voices that are passionate, voices that are intelligent, voices that are helping people across the world.
I study how the brain rebuilds itself, but a flash of inspiration led me to building my own startup. By recycling fast fashion, this product could help millions of women living in poverty.
As an intensive care pediatrician, I've been working in the hospital and the lab throughout the pandemic. My research will help improve our understanding of infections such as pneumonia and COVID-19.
Since Cambridge, I've worked with aid agencies, charities, and NGOs. But now, I'm helping get answers for civilians killed in drone strikes.
Across 31 unique colleges, we reflect a diverse and complicated world. We're poets, politicians, performers, even professors. We come from all walks of life with our own stories to tell.
Losing my grandmother to pancreatic cancer made me want to fight it. And my work with nanoparticles could unlock new answers.
I grew up in a culture where women and girls are expected to endure domestic abuse in complete silence. As a journalist and now scholar, my writing is making sure stories like these do not go untold.
Our backgrounds may be worlds apart, but being a Gates Scholar, that's what binds us together. We're a growing global community, nearly 2,000 strong, tackling the problems that concern the many and the few. Can a scholarship change the world? Well, what do you think?
Hello, I'm Stephen Toope, Vice-Chancellor of the University of Cambridge, and it's a great pleasure to be with you at this year's Alumni Festival. While I'm sorry not to be able to see you all in person, it's still a marvel that we're able to bring so much of Cambridge to our alumni all around the world. The Alumni Festival is many things. It's a celebration of Cambridge's community of curious minds that stretches not just across the globe, but back through history and into the future. It's a chance for our alumni, no matter where you are in the world, to dive more deeply into the research and innovation that is changing the world far beyond our city and university. It's also a call to action. Because when it comes to the pressing challenges facing our institution and our society, our progress depends on the resources, determination, and ingenuity of all of us. Importantly, today is also part of a series of events celebrating 20 years of the Gates Cambridge Scholarship Program. These scholars form a global network of leaders, and also a community of individuals who share a common goal of making the world better. The Gates Cambridge Scholars are among the best minds working on the greatest challenges of our time. Our theme for today's discussion is one of the greatest the world has ever faced: the energy transition needed to address the climate crisis. We know that we must move away and rapidly from fossil fuels. We know that we already have the technologies that will be the foundation of that transition. From solar power to biofuels, green hydrogen to wind turbines, and even algae, as we'll hear more about later. We've made great strides towards embedding cleaner forms of power generation in our societies. And yet, that transition will look very different in the UK than in India or Brazil or Ghana. But there are examples of communities beginning to deliver the transition on their own terms, and this is cause for hope. Communities we'll hear about shortly. This brings me to our three panelists, remarkable people who are at the forefront of these efforts. Professor Allison Smith is professor of plant biochemistry and head of the Department of Plant Sciences at the University of Cambridge. Gates scholar Sandele Metetwa is a PhD student in the Department of Chemistry, whose research interests include the use of green hydrogen as a clean energy carrier. She also serves as chair of Africans in STEM. Gates scholar Ramit Debnath is a PhD student in the Department of Architecture and a computational social scientist. His research focuses on energy and climate justice in the built environment using data science. He deploys machine learning and AI to inform sustainability and policy decisions for climate repair. Following our panel discussion, we welcome your questions, and you can submit these in the Q&A box below. Well, colleagues, you all come from quite different disciplines, but I really note that there seems to be a common theme across your disparate areas of work, different parts of the world, economy. The theme is that what you work on could have huge effects on our ability to deal with the challenges that I've just mentioned in energy, policy, supply change. So tell me a little bit about the research work that you're doing. Let's start with you, Sandele.
Sure. So my research is on assessing the performance of materials that are known as metal organic frameworks as catalyst in splitting water so that you can produce hydrogen. And this hydrogen would be green hydrogen. And what we mean by green hydrogen is when we have zero carbon emissions and also when we're using a renewable energy source. So the renewable energy source that I'm using is solar energy. So simply it's just shining light on a reaction system that contains water and the catalyst, and then through complex electron transfer processes, you then churn out hydrogen. So I must say that this work is more from a research interest perspective to see how you can, you know, potentially form green hydrogen, but it also gives a lot of insight into the more applicable means to which we can form green hydrogen.
Thank you very much. And what about you, Ramit?
My research talks about how these communities who are most vulnerable to effects of climate change or poverty, they access energy services. And I use the lens of energy justice to understand where are the injustices that's happening across the scales. So I have three case studies, India, Brazil, and Nigeria, and they have different characteristics to it. But what happens in the current policymaking exercises is that these contexts are not well established. So using machine learning and voices from the ground, we actually try to classify these contexts and help policymakers to make better decisions.
Thank you. That was both of you really clear. I really appreciate that. Allison, in some ways, your work may seem surprising for some people. So tell us about what you're doing that could have an effect on the energy transition.
So I work with algae, which are simple plants that mainly live in water. They photosynthesize, so they actually take advantage of solar energy, as in Sandile's case, but they use it in biological processes, just like plants on the land. And what we've been doing over the years is thinking about how we might use those in quite different ways to address sustainability issues. So not necessarily biofuels, although there is the prospect of that, but actually thinking of alternative feedstocks for things like bulk chemicals, for a source of protein, which might mitigate against the production of other plant-based proteins, which can have an effect on requiring land clearance and so on. for the production of high-value chemicals in a sustainable way, and also for waste remediation. So algae can grow on all sorts of pretty, you know, horrible things, and produce better type of water, and then maybe some products as well.
So one takeaway already is that we might be eating algae fairly soon. That seems to be...
I think you're probably eating it already.
We probably are, yes.
Maybe more of it.
More of it, absolutely. People talk a lot about clean power and the generation of clean power, but that really can mean so many different things. From the perspective of your work, I'm interested in how you would describe clean power. Ramit, I'll start with you.
Yeah, thank you. A very important part that I realized through my research is that we often talk from the supply side, and no one actually realizes what happens when our connections are sent to our home. Mm. So the communities with whom I work, especially people who live in slums, so they have a very different structures across the three cases that I mentioned in India, Brazil, and Nigeria. And sometimes they get bills after 6 months. Sometimes they don't even get bills, but at the end they get a very lumped amount, which is more than their household income. So it creates a cycle of energy poverty that's very hard to break. And these are happening just at the demand side, because supply side we are quite clear about what's happening. So the transition, how it translates into very contexts and to the community level, is something very interesting to see and also important to bring forward.
Hmm. Alison, for you, clean power, what does it mean?
Well, I think one of the most important things that I've come to realize is the idea of circularity, that producing something in a linear fashion, which is the essential basis of our economy, to maximize the productivity and reduce costs, is not sustainable. And going forward, we actually have to think about how we have a single input. In my case, it would be the solar energy from the sun. And then what you want to do is to generate products but not produce waste streams. Mm. And by being a bit more innovative, perhaps focusing less on maximizing productivity, overall, the sustainability of the process will be better. I mean, it might be a little bit more expensive initially, but I hope that will the increase in sustainability eventually would mitigate those extra costs.
So you're talking about both a physical circularity and an economic circularity.
Yeah.
Sandele, clean energy production, for you, what's that?
So I think for me, it really has to depend on the context of the country that you're looking at. For example, I think different countries need to prioritize different clean energy technologies. And for me, that goes beyond just the physical aspect of it. It also needs to look into what's the social implications, what are the environmental implications. For example, if we think about Ghana, which is a country I'm case studying at the moment, clean energy to them is looking at solar, it's looking at waste to energy, it's looking at nuclear, because one, it's available to them. Two, there's also infrastructure in place for that. There's also expertise and knowledge. There's also investment for that. So I think for me, it's more just about prioritizing what clean energy is for the context, and to also avoid over diversification prematurely, because I think that could lead to, you know, issues related to how do you deal with waste, especially if you're not really knowledgeable about it from the get-go.
You're already getting to one of the themes that I wanted to explore by talking about being particular to a context and understanding you talking about a national context. But one of the things that also ties the work that you do together is that there are specific communities that you work with or engage with as a researcher. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious, and I'll start with you since you raised the issue, Sandele, what does the picture around energy look like for the communities that you deal with in various parts of the global south? You mentioned Ghana.
With Ghana, for example, Ghana has 85% electricity access, and the remaining 50% is mostly for people who are in off-grid communities or island communities. And these really need to be serviced by, you know, either mini-grids or standalone solar systems or waste energy systems. But I think for Ghana, I'll leave that out because I feel it's a more energy secure space than, for example, Zimbabwe, where I'm from. Now, Zimbabwe has almost half energy security as opposed to Ghana, which is about 40% in the country. And I think because of infrastructural challenges and just obsolete equipment, et cetera, there are a lot of power cuts that are faced in the country. So you tend to see a lot of people really don't have energy access. And some people, especially in the urban areas, are looking to solar home systems or home biodigesters, but these really can be expensive, especially if you're looking at the initial capital cost. So I would say the energy need is very strong because you tend to see people then cutting down trees, trying to get biomass to be able to cook or just have, access to some form of energy. So it really, there really has to be some sort of intervention that really looks at how do you then deploy RE technologies in an economically viable way for the larger part of the population who don't have access to energy to be able to get it.
So in a sense, we're not necessarily talking about a transition, but access in the first
place. Energy security is the priority, to be fair, for a lot of African countries before we look at net zero.
Alison, I know that you work with partners, research partners in Uganda. So how does the energy complexity look from that perspective?
Well, yes, I do. We have two or three projects with colleagues at the University of Kampala. And I think one of the things which is really encouraging is I'm not certain about the percentage of energy supply there, but I think one of the things that is really encouraging is the fact that there are many initiatives that are ongoing. So we turn up with our algae and say, look, we can use algae as a solution to everything, and they go, oh yes, okay. But actually, what's interesting is that they have lots of solutions, but they're not very joined up. Actually, they're not very joined up in the UK either, no. But we have a much better infrastructure. And I think being able to work with them and offer guidance or just resource and information then is facilitating them thinking of their own solutions. How can we set up something? We're trying to set up a circular process that I was telling you about, dealing with fruit and vegetable waste in Uganda in markets. Where there's a lot of waste, and they are doing something with it, but it's not completely circular. So we're trying to think of solutions, and we can test those solutions in the UK, and then get colleagues to try and help implement them back in Uganda.
Thank you. Ramit, you actually have a very diverse portfolio of engagements around the Global South. Tell us a little bit about one or two of the communities that you've been working with.
Sure. So I think it's what Sandalay mentioned. I completely agree. Even when I look at a very granular scale in between the community in the neighborhood, it's the same questions of energy access and also more in terms of security. Because even if they have the infrastructure, they don't get bills, and they can't pay the bills because it's a circularity in how they have to break that out. For example, in Mumbai, a very key part is how the urban planning takes place in the slum rehabilitation housings. So they don't have any open space, and that forces people to have a very individualistic living, which they were never, they always lived in community structure with open spaces and sharing practices. So this sudden shift has made energy intensity very high. So this is a very cultural aspect of that. And similarly with Nigerian case that I studied is there are ways that people have to sacrifice a day of wage to get an appliance repaired because they don't have any infrastructure for that, and which is equal to buying a new appliance, which is again a high burden job for the house. So these things are, I mean, across the communities that I study. And very interestingly, in Brazil, the place where I studied, so they received a refrigerator as donations, but these refrigerator already had embedded inefficiency in them. So they are using inefficient refrigerator at a higher price, mm-hmm. and that creates burden to them. Mm-hmm. So that's the cost of convenience, I would say, in energy transition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'd like to explore a little bit further the whole notion of research in partnership with communities. One of the consistent themes that we've been hearing throughout the sessions that we've had for the 20th anniversary of the Gates program is that there is really a need for authentic partnership and indeed equality in the partnership. And for those of us who've worked extensively across the global south, that can sometimes be difficult. There are sort of embedded inequalities that can be quite challenging. I'd love to hear your reflections on how we can best address that kind of challenge in creating genuine partnership.
Right, so I actually work as a local partner in Zimbabwe for a company that's based here, just outside of Cambridge. And they look at innovative solutions for energy access to low-income communities. And one of these is biogas production with biodigesters. So our work as local partners is to actually engage with the beneficiaries beforehand and first having to understand what their particular needs are. Because I think sometimes there's always this generalization of thinking that people need a certain technology deployed to them. And one, they don't even understand how it works. They're never taught how it works. They're never trained on how to maintain it. And I think there have been some interventions in Zimbabwe on biodigesters and biogas, where you know people eventually abandoned these biodigesters because they didn't know how to properly maintain them. So I think this idea of having local partners who, number one, first engage with the beneficiaries before any project starts to understand what their needs are, to also be train them, even from the technical expertise, the science, a little bit of the science behind some of these things, because it's not just all tech. And also just making sure that they feel some certain part of ownership for that technology, because they'll be able to take care of it better, they'll understand it, and even be more innovative, because they could come up with solutions themselves from what we would have provided them at the start. So I think it's just better engagement from the get-go.
Alison, in dealing with your partners in Uganda, have there been challenges around senses of inequality or access to the same kinds of supports, and how do you overcome some of that?
Well, clearly there's a big difference in terms of resource, and we were very fortunate in getting funding to the Global Challenges Research Fund, specifically to send resource to Uganda in a way which then empowered them to start their experiments, to collect the data that we needed for our project. And one of the things which we were very much looking forward to was actually hosting three of the people from Uganda to come to Cambridge and for us to go to Uganda. But unfortunately, because of COVID, that wasn't possible. In fact, whilst, you know, I wouldn't advocate having to do this for the rest of time, Zoom has offered a way of interacting in ways that was really very difficult before. And in fact, before the pandemic, they actually introduced me to Zoom. I'd never heard of it before. They said, oh, this is great. It's much better than Skype because it's you don't have to pay for it. And the process of having the interactions, they were much more familiar with. And we've actually been able to do virtual, it's not quite hands-on, I don't know how, what you call it, you know, using smartphones and saying, you know, this is our piece of equipment, this is what we do, and then they do the same thing, and we say, oh, I think that bit of piping might need adjusting. Mm-hmm. And this is actually, you know, a new way of working, but I think it's actually democratized the whole process much more than them coming here and then being passive observers.
Yeah.
That we're doing the same thing.
in real time, but in different places.
I always think it's encouraging to hear of positive stories that have come out of COVID. So thank you, Alison. Ramit, what are your reflections on dealing with, in fact, a variety of communities?
Yeah, I think I agree with both of the speakers that it's very important that we engage with the communities. So for my study, I usually work with women more specifically, because in these communities, they spend most of their time as compared to the male counterpart. And so from a community level, that engagement has been very successful to get the rich narrative of living through this transition and the inaccess to certain services. But also, I work a lot with higher level policymakers. I think that's very important as well, because they are the ones who dictate some of the terms. Mm-hmm. So I've been working with International Energy Agency to try to mm-hmm. convey some of these messages that we do through core research here, that how it translates to a wider audience, and especially through public engagement, that even a politician who is sitting at a local level, at municipality level, can understand that what we are trying to convey through on energy transition more specifically.
That's interesting, and that's another whole community that we don't always think about, but that community of international policymakers that one has to, as you say, there has to be influence there, or we can't create some of the structures that are needed. So when we talk about the structural energy transition, people often point to two distinct pillars of that transition, one being reducing the cost of zero carbon alternatives, and then secondly, charging for hidden costs of pollution. And I know, for example, Bill Gates, who is instrumental in creating the Gates program, of course, is passionate about finding solutions to those two particular problems. And he describes it as lowering the green premiums, because right now it does always seem as if we worry that green is going to be more expensive and therefore we can't move in that direction. Alison, how do you see that issue playing out in your field?
Well, I think, energy is far too cheap. Certainly in the Western world, it's far too cheap. And it's been, we pay no costs for the pollution that we produce from that. I'm not certain how you would go about calculating the cost, but at the very least, we should be collecting the information that would then enable you to put a charge on that. Mm. So that, and I think there's quite a lot of data in terms of carbon footprints of individuals in developed countries versus developing countries, mm-hmm. in a way which makes it very starkly clear that we are producing a lot more of the emissions. Not this is my field at all, but I would say that supply has got to be balanced with demand. And how do you deal with demand? You probably deal with demand by having an appropriate charging system in some way.
Yeah.
Even if it's your carbon footprint that you're allowed for the year or
mm-hmm.
whatever.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Sandile? How would you see this playing out in the work that you've done?
So I think I'll talk about it in the context of hydrogen.
Yeah.
I spoke briefly about green hydrogen, which is zero carbon emissions and renewable energy source. And I think the competitor of green hydrogen is blue hydrogen, where we still have significantly lowered carbon emissions, but it's derived from non-renewable energy sources, which are much cheaper than renewable energy sources. So I think even the process by which you tend to split the water and get the hydrogen, I think two ways. For me, it's number one, if a lot of investment is put into research and development, just so we can, one, make the process of getting the green hydrogen, cheaper, either through looking at the renewable energy source or just the process in itself, right? And number two, funding startups or entrepreneurs who actually have solutions to some of these things. Because I think the idea is really just about lowering, for me, it's just about lowering the cost of these zero carbon emission alternatives. And I think just by researching more, investing more would work for me, I think.
Thanks. Rama, you must think about this from a policy perspective. So what advice might you give to try to address this dual challenge?
Yeah, I think it's really a tough question, for sure. But I think a very important part, especially from an Indian perspective, is that there has to be a certain amount of international collaboration and tech transfer, mm-hmm. more specifically. For example, my research, I deal with a lot of buildings in general and making them carbon neutral or decarbonize the building. But the problem is these are all there in policy, but in practice, not many people are trained on how to do a green building. So that granular level, action is needed, I would say. Mm-hmm. And it's a game of numbers. So more people do it, the more it will become prominent in the space. And that can create a cycle. And I think a very important part of that is tech transfer, that how different technology can help bring that, but also teaching the local community on how to do that very effectively. It's not just one way, it's more right. of two-way transfer.
Thank you. Just to remind all of you that we're looking for exciting questions. They're starting to come in. I'm going to ask one more question of our panelists, and then I will come to your questions. So a final question then, and I'll start with you, Sandile, if I may. It's a big, hard question, but what does a just energy transition actually look like in the areas that you work in?
So that's been a question I've been asking over and over again for the past 2 weeks, because I was in Ghana and we were having interviews with energy stakeholders and we're asking them a question: what does a just energy transition mean in Ghana? So honestly, I think one thing that came up was it really has to be striking a balance between how much fossil fuels you have and how much renewables you have in your energy mix. In Ghana, or in a lot of African countries, it is not probably going to be 100% renewables anytime soon, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a very local, nuanced, and very specific idea of what transition means. And I think each country, especially in Africa, should be able to define for themselves what that means to them. And it's really about, you know, what is the state of their industrialization? They still need to industrialize, and fossil fuels are, you know, what actually can help them do that. But they still need to be able to include renewables into that energy mix. But how much of renewables do they need to put in? That's the big question, because they don't know. So really, I think it's really about seeing what RE tech is a priority for them, putting in, increasing the, how much they can over the years. But obviously, the pace needs to also catch up, because global warming affects everybody, even if, the emissions that people produce are not the same. So I think it's really more about pacing themselves, but not necessarily having to pace themselves as much as the West is.
So, I mean, historical inequalities here are really continuing to play out, and it forces a much more nuanced analysis at the local and national levels. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Ramit, what about in the places that you work? How would you see a just energy transition?
I think it's a very interesting question, because that's what my examiners asked 2 days back. That's the first question.
He's just had his PhD examination and passed, so we should all be congratulating him too. It's great news.
Thank you. Yeah, so I think it's very similar to what Sandile said. And for me, I had a very close experience with that you need to contextualize the problems and bring it up to the ones who are responsible for placing up the policies. That for some communities, just transition means just getting reliable electricity 24/7. And for some, it means getting the liquefied petroleum gas in the kitchen as a clean form of energy, in my cases. And for some, it's the ability to pay bills right on time. So these things are often looked into the broader, not looked into the broader discussions of just transition, but from a very bottom-up and grounded point of view, just transition would include adding more contexts to these problems. Mm. And
So I think I'm going to come now to questions from you, because they're flooding in, and I want to make sure that we get quite a few of them before we run out of time. And in a way, the first question is a continuation of what we've just been talking about. And the question is, how do we pursue the dual goals of energy security and energy transition at the same time? Is it actually possible to do that in large parts of the world? And if we do, how can that happen? I know that's a really tough question. But Alison, any ideas?
Well, I guess one of the things that I would like to say is that thinking about energy in its own context, separate from the rest of the economy and the rest of the way that society runs, is probably the worst thing to do. Mm. Because actually it means that it's its own parallel stream. And I believe that we should be thinking about sustainability, and energy is part of that. And so I think it is possible to contextualize where you get the energy from. If you do need, if you are needing to use fossil fuels in order to secure your energy supply, how do you mitigate the consequences of using those fossil fuels? Mm. Can you incorporate carbon capture? Can you incorporate other ways to remediate it? And I think by focusing simply on energy, you miss opportunities. Mm. And I think this is where maybe it's difficult to do it globally, but I think in a local context, I think it is very important to do that. Even if you do have a transition completely to renewables, if they're not sustainable in the round, then what have you achieved?
Yes. So.
Thank you. Ramit.
Yeah, thank you. I completely agree with Alison said. And also, I think a very strong tool that we have is digitalization. That's going on, and especially in very remote communities, the influence of ICT devices like a smartphone. So I think they are going to play a huge role in understanding these invisible drivers of energy demand, let's say, and the solutions that we can bring on to decarbonize them. So for example, in my case study, I think a smart meter will do wonder, because people can actually see how much is they are spending and what's the bills that are they going to have. And also from the other side, it's, for example, if we have a renewable solution, so they can integrate very well in that digital sphere. So I think that's a very strong tool at our disposal.
Mm. Anything you'd like to add, Sandele?
Not really. I agree with both of them. And I think that we really can't treat those two things differently. Because, for example, if there's no energy security, we can use RE technologies to fulfill or complement that insecurity, right? And that is part of energy transition. Mm. So I do think that if there's enough will, it can happen.
There's a clear sense of urgency emerging in the questions, and I'm sure we all share that sense of urgency. That's why we're here. But one intervener has asked whether there are any platforms or tools that could help us ensure that we're not duplicating efforts and to share best practices. I mean, we've talked a lot about local engagement and understanding the local, but the flip side of that is not, you know, so-called reinventing the wheel for every separate intervention. Are you aware of any methods that currently exist? You might be best placed to this because of your digital interests that allow us to share best practices around the energy transition most effectively?
Yes, I think it's a very trendy topic now, especially even from a perspective of intergovernmental organizations like IEA, which is International Energy Agency. So there is a huge consensus on digitalization and how do we inform and teach a different set of policymakers to best use those, and so that we avoid reinventing the wheel every time. So I think these platforms are there, and also the white papers and publications and communication channels that they use. So these are all in place, and some private companies also have platforms where consumers can directly engage with them. Hmm. So for example, in the UK, Octopus Energy is one of them, where you have platforms where basically you collect the collective intelligence of your consumer to inform some decisions that been going on in the energy sector. So I think we have these, and again, with digital data, big data, and I think machine learning, these things are getting more systematic.
Are they yet operating at scale, or no? So we're still dealing with pilots, essentially.
Yes, pilots, this. Mostly. Yeah.
Have you seen anything like that in the work that you've been doing in Ghana at all?
No, yeah. But I would like to make a comment. So, I mean, there are forums, for example, the World Economic Forum, that does a lot of reports and shows our, like, energy transition index. But interestingly, the country that was being studied was actually not aware of such a report being out there. Mm. But I mean, I just found that interesting. But I do think there are platforms that are there to be able to look at such data.
I'm going to continue with you, if I may, because there's a question specifically addressed to you, Sandilia, which is about growth of population in African cities.
Yes.
In particular. It's not unique to Africa, but it's definitely happening fast in many parts of Africa. And the sense of how to keep pace with the growth of population and energy insecurity and energy transition. Mm-hmm. I mean, are you at all optimistic that there are mechanisms in place to manage the growth from an energy perspective?
Again, I think it really depends on the country. So I will bring up Ghana again. And I think this was also one question that we asked them. You know, the population is growing, so, you know, 85% is not going to be 85% in 10 years' time. So that's where the idea of complementing with renewable energy technologies really needs to come into place. They might not need it now, because I think with Ghana also, they have the issue of they actually have an overcapacity of energy at the moment, so they are using less than they actually have. But, you know, other factors come into play. But I think really it's thinking about it now, which is something that we made clear, that it's important to think about some of these issues now. Make sure you are complementing, increasing the energy mix of RE in place for what could happen in the next 10 or 20 years.
Ramit, a question specifically for you around long-term financing opportunities and the potential of data science, it's connecting the two. Can we get to a position where we have sensible long-term financing for the transition that then relies on good data science to produce logical, longer-term approaches here? I think that's what the questioner is trying to get at.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very good question, I would say. Thank you. And I strongly believe that that's, data is the new money, if I would say, and a reliable source, and especially with dealing with all the issues relating with how we collect the data and whether it's a representative of the society and the problem that we are seeing. I think it can offer long-term solutions, especially even with the existing technologies that we have. But it's the question of sustainable financing. Who is going to finance? And, I mean, how much return are they going to get in the short term? And can they wait for the longer term? But, I mean, if I just take a step back and zoom out, then with the climate urgency that we have, I think it's a very good option that we should explore in financing and getting out there with digital tech like smart meters.
There's obviously, in some of the questioners, a sense of frustration about inequality and the pressure that is placed on the global south as we're all trying to make this massive energy transition.
Yeah. Yes.
Alison, this is a really tough one, but I'll start with you. The question is, shouldn't the onus really be on the wealthy to decarbonize more rapidly and not to be asking so much of the global south?
Well, I suppose, yes, but how do you do that? I think that's the big issue. I think this is where I think the demand side is important. How do you encourage people to use less energy in the Western democracies? And how do you then transfer that sort of carbon budget, if you like, to the developing and lower income countries? And one of the ways I think is doing, as we talked about before,
is actually co-creation and developing solutions in partnership, so that the knowledge base that we have and the resources that we have should be, to the extent it's possible, transferred as soon as we can, but actually not imposed. You know, it should be made available. I think one of the things which is really encouraging, as I said, is that there are very many solutions, and providing the means to allow individual countries to come up with their solutions is probably a better way of doing it than saying, you know, here, have this piece of equipment that you don't really know how to fix, or you know, we're not going to repair or provide you the spares and so on. And interesting, in the work that we're doing, which is this sort of idea of circular processes, it turns out that many small villages, many small communities already do something like that.
Yes.
We're not really inventing anything. We're just providing perhaps a slightly more sophisticated version of it.
So. That's very interesting, and it makes a lot of sense. Ramit, you've already emphasized the need for international cooperation. Can you push that further and be provocative around how we balance the pressure on the global south and, as you put it, focus also on reducing demand? That's another question that's come up. Why are we talking about supply? What about getting demand down? Well, we're not going to get demand down in much of the global south because there's so much energy insecurity, but we should be in the global north, it seems. So how do you balance those?
Yeah, I think for the demand side, a very key role, behavioral adaptation and behavioral science in general is going to play a lot of role, especially in modulating how people use certain technology and the energy intensity around it. And similarly with the international cooperation, it's that how technology is transferred and how the local people are taught to use that and also repair that specific piece of technology and carry it forward. So there, the local innovation plays a strong role, that you customize it and contextualize that technology to the local need. And I think that's a huge step that's lagging in the demand side, that how do we convince people to not operate ACs at 16 degrees centigrade in a city like Mumbai, right, but rather you do it at 24 degrees centigrade, which is comfortable enough, but right, it also solves the problem of coal, I mean, using a lot of coal-based electricity. Yeah, so I think these kind of nudges and clues can be very helpful.
Sandele, you've worked not only with very local communities, but I think it's national level, talking, as you said, to policymakers. Mm-hmm. How frustrated are they in the global discussions about the perspectives of North and South?
I think it depends on who you talk to.
Of course it does.
But some are they were visibly frustrated. But I think it always goes back to, well, global warming affects everybody, so we still need to play our part. But in terms of how much of a part they need to play, because I need to say something in terms of how financing is actually quite difficult for some countries to get to do proper RE projects. Because one, I think Africa contributes less than 3% to total global carbon emissions. And because of that, there isn't much financing that's deployed to Africa, mainly because there's no need to, you know, as compared to Asian countries or South American countries where, you know, global emissions are quite high. So they need more of RE because it really pulls back on their emissions. So it's really like, if you're not financing us, but you want us to, what are we cutting down actually? What are we supposed to do? So it really, there is a lot of frustration there, but people still realize that, you know, just for even energy security, just to have a cleaner environment, they need to play their part. But how much part do they need to play is the question.
Mm-hmm. Interesting question, which points out that we've been focusing on alternative energy sources, so-called solar, hydrogen, etc., wind. What about the move within fossil fuels from higher to lower emitting fossil fuels, from coal to gas?
Yeah.
How important is that as an element of the energy transition, do you think?
I
think you've hinted,
yes,
that it's pretty important.
It is very important.
Do you want to just
continue.
Yes, because, again, Ghana, they have a lot of natural gas deposits. They cannot just abandon them. And natural gas is cleaner than coal, it's cleaner than oil. So they need to make use of them. And to them, natural gas is an energy transition fuel.
Yes.
So I think that that really needs to be factored in as an energy transition fuel, because while it holds the same energy density as well and proves to be much cheaper. So yes, they are onwards with that. That to them is an energy transition fuel.
Alison, certainly a different context in the United Kingdom around this. I think a lot of people would argue that that's, you know, evading the real transition that needs to happen.
Yes, I think the issue is really that we can't switch immediately to not using fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. What we have to do is have the conversation about what we use the fossil fuels for. What can we do things with using renewable energy, and what should we be doing? And then we have to use the fossil fuels as the sort of, you know, the backup, rather than it the other way around, as you're suggesting you might need to do in Ghana and places. And I think one of the things which is, if you think about it, even if we don't do anything with our fossil fuels, they will run out. Mm-hmm. They're a finite resource. Mm-hmm. And so, let's say in 100 years' time, we won't be able to have this conversation. So how do we conserve them best for the future? I think that's something that's really important to discuss.
And it's a hard discussion to have, because it becomes highly politicized very quickly. Yes. Ramit, one of the other issues that's being raised by people online is the whole question about what works in convincing governments that they really need to act. And you've seen this probably from the global level and from the community level. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on whether you've seen any good practices about what's most effective, either from communities demanding change around fuel and the energy transition, or the international organizations trying to create incentives or pressures towards it.
Yeah, I think it's both way that you mentioned very nicely, is that, for example, from my community studies, I have seen many people come together to install solar rooftop as a solution, because they have been telling their local government for quite some time to find a solution. But it's the community-driven solution, and which is good in short term, but in long term it's not quite sustainable, because who will fund for their maintenance for a longer term? Mm-hmm. So that's where I think these kind of nudges and push sometimes helps a lot in convincing local governance to act. And from a very top-down view, it's the roles of international agencies, and especially funding bodies. If they set the goal very provocatively against a clean transition. So, for example, India has a very strong renewable target of 100 gigawatt by, I think, 2030 or 2040. So that kind of target also acts as a national nudge, if I can say.
But do you see that as kind of conditionality? There was a big argument in 20 years ago about aid conditionality and sort of forcing governments through financing mechanisms. The World Bank was often accused of doing that. Or are you talking more about incentives, or both?
I think it's the incentives which are the best tools that we have, and especially now we know how to do randomized trials of certain programs and then get the feedback from there that whether this action works or not. And similarly, forcing any government will not work, especially from the funding body, and that creates the divide that already exists in terms of implementation of those things. But I think if we can incentivize and get nice policies from the grounded data that we can generate, I think that will help.
Great. We're unfortunately running out of time, but one last question, if I may, for each of you. Same question. Given the work that you're doing and everything that you read and see in this field, how optimistic are you that we actually can make a rapid enough energy transition to meet zero carbon goals by, say, 2050? Alison?
Well, I'm an optimist. And I guess I'm maybe it's just whistling to the wind, but I would say you have to be optimistic. It doesn't look good, but if you, I think we have started, and I think there is an impetus and a sense that things have got to change. And maybe, you know, maybe one more thing, good thing that's come out of COVID, is that it is possible to change, you know, mm-hmm. overnight.
More rapidly than we could have imagined.
Than we could imagine.
Yeah. Ramit.
Yeah, I am very optimistic that even if it's not a cumulative scale, we definitely have a capacity to do a sectoral transition towards net zero by 2050, more specific. So I think that's, I mean, I work with a lot of new startups that come up to using tech to reduce carbon emissions and to facilitate more energy transition, and especially also from the point of view which never existed. For example, a very close friend, he found a startup which uses natural language processing to understand people's views on energy transition, and which he directly feeds into policymakers. Table. So I think this is a very nice snowballing effect that has started.
Great. 1 minute. I'm sorry, Sandale, for a lot.
That's fine. I'm also quite optimistic, but I think with conversations I've had with people, I've realized that political will tends to be the biggest bottleneck in all of this. And I mean, there's political will, there's also the economic side of things. So I feel like there has to be more advocating towards that. And like you said, you know, with the idea of COVID, a lot of things changed overnight. If people could actually see firsthand of what really climate change means, global warming and all of that, I think people would act. But we don't want to get to that point when we are potentially burning. So I think that there has to be enough political and economic will to make a change.
Great. Well, thank you very much. Our panelists, I think, have led a vibrant and, dare I even say, energetic discussion. Alison, Ramit, Sandale, I think that your work really embodies the spirit and indeed the mission of the Gates Cambridge Scholars Program. I do want to just highlight a couple of upcoming Alumni Festival events on the 28th of September, a Tuesday at 1 p.m. British Standard Time. Two of Cambridge's leading economists will discuss their thoughts on COP26. And to close the Alumni Festival on the 28th in the evening, I'll be joined by Dr. Emily Shuckborough, Director of Cambridge Zero. In closing, I want to thank the entire Cambridge Gates community, and most importantly, the Bill Gates and Melinda French Gates Foundation for their extraordinary support for this really remarkable program. Thank you very much.
For as long as I've known, my commitment to public service has always been my driving force. And so I count myself lucky. I come from a very matriarchal family, but as a public international lawyer, I work in areas where women and girls are often sidelined. As a young African girl growing up in three continents, I understood the importance of human mobility across borders as well as within them. But while working with the UN in Sudan, South Sudan, and Somalia, there was always something I noticed. When nations clash over borders, cross-border communities fare the worst, and it's women and children who are most affected. I saw that these communities have legal rights that are invisible to domestic and international law. This legal gap is why I became a Gates Cambridge Scholar. Because Indigenous people make up nearly 370 million people across the world. Because international borders affect transboundary communities from the Irish border to Kurdistan and Kashmir. During my PhD, I've identified this glaring gap in domestic and international law. And now the real work begins. One border, one transboundary community, or one family at a time. This is the difference a Gates Cambridge Scholar can make. Leading a life that's bigger than ourselves, using the knowledge we gain to challenge the very assumptions on which this world is built, aiming high and achieving even higher, This is what it means to be a Gates Cambridge Scholar. Whether it's developing treatments for cancers, delivering vaccines at the touch of a finger, tackling fast fashion, period poverty, or both together, understanding our place within the world, or even out of it. Every year, this unique scholarship transforms the lives of 80 of the world's most talented minds, who go back into the world to improve the lives of millions. It's why someone like me is speaking with you today. And it's why the world needs more Gates Cambridge Scholars. Because we want to share our knowledge to make an impact. Because we want to answer the difficult questions and help solve the biggest challenges. Can a scholarship change the world? I know it can.